Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to bring to the stage Mr. Tobin Bell. Get involved in the Saw franchise?
James Wan. I sat with him for about a half an hour. And we talked about the film. And it was a TV series on at the time. Once and Again, and I had played the father of one of the people on the TV series, and but I didn't, you didn't really see me. I wore a fedora and a trench coat, and this character in the TV series, his father, the character was psychotic. And his father, whenever he would get in a difficult situation, his father would talk to him. But his father would say things to him. So you would see me, but you would just see the coat and the hat and kind of in the shadows. And I would say things to him like, you're never gonna be any fucking good. You're never gonna be able to deal with this. So why don't you just stop trying, you know? Things encouraging. So the casting director who cast that show remembered me and sent me to see James when the Saw movies came up. And so I went and sat with James and talked to him and talked about the script. And I had never worked with Danny Glover, and I wanted to work with Danny. And I had a car payment. And that's it.
So how do you personally, how do you classify Jigsaw? He didn't really kill anyone. Do you think he's a serial killer in your mind? How would you classify that?
Absolutely not. Did people die as a result of his actions? Yes. But there was always an opportunity for them to survive. I wasn't really thinking when I was playing him about him as a serial killer. I was much more interested in his mindset and the fact that the level of his commitment the fact that so many people don't like things in this world and complain mightily, but do nothing about it, whether you agree with what he did or not. He was on a course that he was committed to. When a script takes you in a certain direction, they don't need an actor to play that. They need, I believe, an actor to fill in the human elements, because that was often not on the page. Clearly the events are gonna play out. There's gonna be people, they're gonna be in traps, he's gonna be in his warehouse, it's gonna be, you know, all that stuff. They don't need an actor. It's down there. You know, you're gonna see the lighting and the special effects, and the events are gonna take place. Only humans can fill in the elements that make you care about characters and interest you and make you say, oh yeah, no, I understand that because I had this experience or that experience. That's what actors do. And that's what's interesting about being an actor. mean, unlike a trumpet player any other painter, actors, who use you to create the elusive element of art. And hopefully you can do it as interestingly as possible. And that doesn't mean going necessarily the same direction that the story takes you. You can sometimes layer something. Horror has been the weak sister of filmmaking for many years, because for many years, script writers, producers, directors, they didn't care about the human elements. They just cared about the scares. So the scripts weren't very good, and it was all about the effects. So as a result, not considered artistic or nuanced or delicate. But you can do as much in the horror genre as you can in any other genre if the writing is good and the acting is good. You just have to be committed to doing that. So you don't play, I don't think of myself as a horror actor. You don't become an actor to become one thing or another. It's a circuitous career. You never know. I mean, I didn't know Saul was going to happen. I played astronauts and priests cowboys and farmers, so keep your eyes open, because things are coming at you, you don't know where they're coming from.
I find Jigsaw and John Kramer interesting because to the characters that survived his traps, they sort of consider him a hero of sorts for changing their lives, and no other horror icon really delivered that type of dichotomy. What are your thoughts on that aspect of the character?
Good. Because that's what we were talking about. There's always another side to something. And that's what's interesting about that. That's what I mean about horror as it has been traditionally, kind of one-dimensional in that way. So the fact that that's another side of the same coin. It's Zen Buddhism all over. I saw a tattoo on somebody. Said every pain is everything that hurts is not painful. That was what the tattoo said. Everything that hurts is not painful. Whatever that means to you.
So as the series went on, the traps the Jigsaw laid became even more deranged, more elaborate. Do you have a personal favorite? From the series?
Well, the use of the word favorite, it makes me want to put my arms around it. A couple come to mind, but for some reason, I went through the 60s, and in the 60s, people used to refer to cops and law enforcement, judges, as pigs. The pigs are coming, And there is I think it's in 3, there's a big vat, and there's a judge in the vat. And there are pigs. And maybe the films better than I do, but I can't quite remember, do the pigs fall in the vat, or are they floating in the vat? But I just thought that the metaphor for, I mean, because this judge, the judge was somehow decided the refrigerator woman that was in that film had a son who was injured in a car crash, and the judge had had made a decision that was unfair or you know, wrong, or and I thought that one was really, because I was a child in the 60s, and I had heard that the pig so often, so as soon as I saw that traffic, I thought, wow, that's so cool, you know, you got pigs, and the judge, and law enforcement, and authority. So I like that one. Like the simple ones. Like the ones that have to do with people's karma. Like the needle pit that Shawnee falls into. Or goes into, chooses to go into. There's an actor in, is it two? I think it's two, yeah, in the house, who is an arsonist, who burns up in a incinerator. Harm. Very good actor, by the way, that guy. He's perfect for that part. Like the ones that have to do with karma. And there was times when they kind of drifted away from that concept. I liked it when it was connected. I always liked when the dots connect, subtly.
Now, for people our age that were born in the 80s, we sort of missed the Freddy Jason, and the 90s weren't so great for horror, and then the Saw franchise came around. And you were truly one of our first horror icons, playing Jigsaw. As an actor, what does that mean to you, that you were able to sort of establish that status as a horror icon?
Totally outside my control. I did not know, but the first time somebody said that to me, I was like, what's a horror, what do you mean by a horror? What is a horror icon? That having been said, like I said, you never know how things are going to happen. I can't. I have nothing to do with that. That the fact that I have done that, that's the universe in some way just creating whatever it does, you know. I appreciate it. Because I appreciate horror fans. I've learned to appreciate the passion and dedication and affection that you people have for the genre. And so the fact that I am like a part of that, much gratitude.
So when watching the films, I'm in, I'm reminded now, speaking with you, your voice is amazing. So, in post-production, did they do any work to your voice, as Jigsaw?
Yeah, they did with the tapes. They distort them slightly. I don't know what they do. I never see that. I go into a studio and do the tapes. Actually, originally in Saw 1, we did them on the set. Gary would scramble across the floor and find a tape recorder and press it, and they'd call me, and I was on the floor for 12 days and so on. If you saw a foot or a piece of a body or anything in the shot, it was me. If it was a close-up of Carrie and Lee, I probably wasn't there, but they would call me and I would come in and I would read these things. And that's kind of how we came up with the voice. And I don't know, it was never discussed. I just took the tape recorder and read what it said. and we kept it, and they distorted it slightly. But when I would do it, often I'd be, we did the first show in Los Angeles. This is the rest of them we did in Toronto on stage. And so I would go into a studio after work one day and record them all, whatever was in the show. And they would do whatever they did. I never knew what they would do. I mean, it sounded like me, but they would make it more like a cheap tape recorder. Yes. Yes, they did distort it. That's the long version. Yes.
So horror films usually have social commentaries hidden within the films. In the Saw films, what are some of the more powerful social commentaries that you've noticed?
For some reason, the treatment of the terminally ill by the medical profession comes to mind. That comes up frequently from Saw 1, and it comes up again in Saw 6. But the one that seems to have made the most impression on people, and I'm talking about from seven-year-olds, who groups of them that approach me on baseball fields or wherever, you know, and want to talk about the Saw films, they say, "Hey, you're the man, yeah, yeah." And I say, "Yeah, well, I love those films, so good." Now, these are 10-year-old kids. And they say, I say, "Oh yeah, what do you love about them?" And they say, "They teach you stuff." I said, "Like what?" "Those who don't appreciate life don't deserve life." That's what they talk about. They don't talk about the traps. They don't talk about the, you know, I'm sure it's a horror film, so those things are key, very important, hugely important. But that particular theme comes up over and over again. Those who don't appreciate life don't deserve life. And, you know, we're all struggling to appreciate. We're so freaking lucky to be where we are. The world has descended into violence and hatred, you know, and we are able to live in a country that where you can have relative safety and freedom. And so, not to get political, but it's true. I mean, I struggle with it every day in terms of the things that I have to be grateful for. The mind tends to go to the negative. It just does. So I'm not talking to you, I'm talking to myself.
So maybe on a little bit of a later night. You played the record store on Seinfeld. Can you tell us about your time on the set there in Seinfeld?
Loved Kramer, loved Newman. What's not to love about those guys? You know, what I loved about working on Seinfeld was that Kramer and Newman and Jerry and Elaine, and they were all on the producer level. So if something wasn't working, they had enough clout to go, "You know what, that doesn't work, but you know what, let's do this instead," and they could just change it. And a lot of other sitcoms are writer controlled, you know, everything has to be cleared through a writers, all that stuff. But these people, they were the writers. They weren't the writers, but Jerry was. But, you know, that part of it was great. It was, and to be on the, you know, anytime you're on a show like that, that's so successful. And so, I mean, I did an episode of The Sopranos, and I was like, wow, so happy to be here, you know, young. You know, I did 6 episodes of 24. It was hugely popular at that point. So anytime you can work with people who have achieved a lot, whether you're their biggest fans or you're not, they've achieved a lot. You know, I mean, I've gotten to work. I did 3 films with Gene Hackman. You know, and worked with Tom Cruise. And you know, whether you think somebody's a great actor or not, they've achieved. You know, they're talk about icons. I mean, these people are, so I've been very fortunate in that way that I've had a chance to not only do some great shows, but work with some really great actresses. And then all of a sudden, you know, you become a horror icon on top of that. It's just the greatest. Thanks to you guys.
Now, another film you were in, you mentioned Gene Hackman, The Quick and the Dead. You played Doug Kelly. Can you talk about that role and that experience on that set?
Love Westerns. You know, grew up on, you know, I mean, Westerns aren't that popular these days, but they used to be hugely popular in film, and they kind of meant movies at one point in time. You know, great movies of John Ford and great Westerns. Throwback to early Americana, living on the frontier, you know, that whole kind of thing. It's one of the great things about being an actor is that you get to do things that you wouldn't ordinarily get to do, you know, like rob a bank, or, you know, drive a fast car, or, you know, ride a horse, you know, learn how to use a gun, you know, learn how to shoot a gun, you know. So you get to go places and do things that you wouldn't ordinarily do. Small towns in America, you know, locations, all great stuff, and you get paid.
So, on the Saw franchise, do you remember anything, shooting anything that didn't make it into the final cut? Anything that you thought was particularly interesting because of, you know, such a rabid fan base?
I've had so many scenes cut from films. Nothing, not from Saw, but from The Quick and the Dead. I had a wonderful scene with Sharon Stone, but there were so many stars in that film that they had to honor these stars. I wasn't a big star. Russell Crowe is in The Quick and the Dead, Leonardo DiCaprio, Lance Hendrickson, Gene Hackman. Who else is in it? There's another big star, Sharon Stone. There wasn't enough screen time for this scene, so I lost this nice scene with Sharon Stone. I had a scene in Goodfellas with Robert De Niro. It's reduced to a handshake. he shakes his hand, and I come in, he comes into my office. We had six lines, you know, behind a desk. It's not, so it happens all the time. It's part of, but it hasn't happened in Saw. Most everything that we've shot, one of the most rewarding experiences of Saw was in Saw 2. There was a certain amount of concern that Donnie Wahlberg and I could not make sitting at a table interesting or horror-like. Because I have like seven scenes with him in that, and he goes out and he comes back, and he goes out and he comes back, and I'm sitting at this kitchen table, and I was, we had 10 days. It was written in a certain kind of way, and Donnie arrived in town, and we had 10 days before the film was shot, and Darren, the director, was his first film, his first major feature. And Donnie would come in, he would look at the script and he'd go, "It's fucking ridiculous. I'm not gonna say that." I'd go, "Okay, what are you gonna say?" And I was so grateful because I thought it was fucking ridiculous too. But Donnie sort of had the clout and so we worked on these scenes at the table, and they got better and better and better, and we would meet with Darren in the bar. He was shooting all day long, and they'd come to this bar at night, and we'd go over the scenes with Darren, and he'd go, okay. And he'd take the piece of paper, and he'd show it to the on-set producer, who was Greg Hoffman, and he'd say, "This is what they want to say." And Greg would look at it, and he'd go, "Oh, wow, that's much better." And give it back to Darren. So Darren was like, "Oh, thank you." because he didn't have, Darren wasn't sure, you know, and Greg had the clout to say yes. So, anyway, what'd you ask me?
It's really just about outtakes, to be honest with you.
About outtakes, yeah. So, you asked me whether stuff had been cut. And it gets cut all the time, and it gets changed all the time. And one of the most rewarding experiences I had was that these scenes at that table didn't get changed at all. They're just the way we worked them out over those 10 days. And when I saw the film, I was like, wow. Because very often, pacing, dialogue, in edit, gets manipulated and changed and paced differently and everything, just the way we did. Just the way we set out to do it. So it seemed kind of theatrical to me, like a theater piece, and I really appreciated that.
Now, in the first Saw, it was tight budget, quick time frame.
18 days.
I saw an interview with you, and you stated the end scene where you took off the prosthetic on your head, that was a very important scene. Talk a little bit about why that was so important, because it was...
They didn't have time to do two takes. You know, that's what happens in, you know, relatively low budget films. They're up against a time crunch, and the producers were very concerned that we weren't going to get it in one take. The removal of this device, and to put it back together again, would have taken Rocky Faulkner, who Rocky. Thank you. He did all the prosthetics and saw one a couple of hours at least to put back together. So but they got it in one take, the shot that they wanted. And we didn't have to do more than that. They were very worried about time.
You spoke a little bit about theater in the previous question. And you've done some theater work. Do you prefer one of the other, or they both have different challenges, and just what's your take on that?
I always wanted to be a film actor. I did a lot of theater in New York. I lived in New York for 39 years, and did a lot of theater in New York. Studied the Neighborhood Playhouse, worked for many years at the Actors Studio, and always came. I came to New York to be a film actor. That's what I wanted to do. But it took a long time. I mean, it took Dustin Hoffman 18 years before he worked. It took Hackman 21 before he really worked. And 64, 85, 21 years before. I always thought that if I was able to persevere, that some director, somebody would recognize something in me. Alan Parker, the English director, hired me to do Mississippi Burning in 1985, and that helped to move me into gainful employment.
I also read that you were in, I think, 30 films before you spoke?
More than 30. I worked with Woody Allen, Sidney Lumet, Scorsese, many actors. They would say to me, how can you do that? You know, just like walk down the street with a suitcase or a briefcase, or, you know, cross the street, or be a cop or be a skier on the ski slopes or whatever it was. And I just wanted to be close to the camera. I wanted to find out by watching, and I did a lot of stand-in work too, which was, they rehearse. In the old days, before digital, people would go back to their trailers, and it would take them 3 hours. The actors would go back to their trailers, and it would take 3 hours for them to light. They don't have to do that anymore. And with digital, there's much more sensitivity. They use different lighting and everything, so there's not as much waiting as there used to be. But in those days, during that lighting process, the stand-ins would walk. You know, whatever they did in the rehearsal, you watched the rehearsal, and then you were the person who acted out what the actor did. And so I did a lot of that work as well. I wanted to be as close to the camera as I could be to see if I thought I could do what they were doing.
Before you got into the business, who did you look up to in show business?
Harry Belafonte comes to mind. Ilya Kazan. Marlon Brando. People who became the character on the screen. Actors who became the character. And I would even say an actor like Gary Cooper, who had very little training but had the ability to just be himself. Before I became an actor, who did I admire? Good question.
Did you have a specific inspiration for Jigsaw, maybe like a real life person or anything like that?
No, not really. The kind of persistence and determination, that someone has to. I was on a train the other day and I was like, I started putting down how many jobs I had had during the 21 years it took me to actually work. I had 53 different kinds of jobs, from loading mattresses on tractor trailer trucks to busing tables to washing dishes, you name it, I did it, parking cars. So what was the question again?
Did you have someone in mind when you portrayed yourself?
Oh yeah. To persist over 21 years requires a certain kind of commitment. Jigsaw is a very committed guy. So I figured, I could get, there's a lot of things I can get behind. If you love a particular band, it's that kind of passion, that kind of belief that he has. So I just do the same thing I do with every other character. I don't play a guy like Jigsaw differently than I do somebody's father. I do the same kind of work. I ask myself, who am I, where am I, what do I want, when do I want it, and how am I going to get it?
So there's been rumors of another Saw. You have any...
Talks cheap.
Until they offer you a contract.
I never believed they were going to do any more Saws until I was actually on the set. It's true, because you never, then you know what's happening, I wasn't counting on them doing, I was busy doing other things.
I'm going to go to the audience now. If anybody has any questions, raise your hand. I'll come over with the microphone.
I forgot we were going to do that. The lady with the flower in her hair, that's you. Favorite movie?
Yeah.
Mississippi Burning. Important film, historical film, textured, fine performances by Francis McDormand, and Hackman, and Willem Dafoe. I like films that are important, and I did my best to make John Kramer of significance. Not just give him as much weight as I could give him.
You got to work with two of my favorite actresses in the Saw franchise, Shawnee Smith and Betsy Russell. How was it like working with them?
It was great. I'll start with Betsy. I thought it was fascinating that they picked Betsy to be John's wife. I thought it was brilliant because if he's as good at what he does, as he was, that he should be with a beautiful woman and have a really great taste in female, And they could have picked anybody for her. They could have gone the other way, and, but they picked Betsy, and Betsy, so I appreciated the eye candy. And secondly, Shawnee, adore Shawnee. We were able to infuse the Amanda-John relationship with some textural connection. And that's what you really want. If you can do that, if you can connect in that way, then that's feels really right and good and not wasted time. And it isn't always easy. The person you're with, sometimes you're playing with, you're working with a wall. You know, it's, but Shawnee was into it. She wanted to connect. And I so much appreciate that.
Hello, Tobin.
Hello.
Is there any franchise, horror or not, that you've ever thought to yourself, like, man, I would love to be part of that?
I am not familiar with any franchise horror. I'm honestly not. I don't know. I'd like to be part of any, with the creator, when the creators, I want to work with Vince Gilliam. You know, I mean, Breaking Bad was terrific. I mean, I'd like to do a Game of Thrones guy. So, I'm working on a film right now in Mexico. I came up here from Mexico City, and I'm returning there tomorrow. And I'm working with an actress in that film, and she was her greatest desire is to be in Game of Thrones. That's all she cares about. She wants to be in Game of Thrones. That's her goal. That's where she's going. Like, I wanted to be in films. She wants to be in Game of Thrones. That's all. It's very, very dedicated. A horror franchise that I would like to be part of. If the writing's really good, see, horror franchise, horror comes with this baggage. As soon as you say it, you kind of, it's like saying, is there any, I don't know why. I think it's because of the history of horror in film, you know? I want to be in anything that's well written. Because if it's well written, it's worth showing. It's part of the human condition. The world is fucking horror right now. So what do you mean by horror? What do you mean by horror? What do you mean by it? Does it mean that you, are you speaking as an audience member? I asked a friend of mine once, why do you go to horror films? I was living in New York. She was going to a horror film. I never went to horror films. And I said, why do you go to horror films? She said, because it's like sex. You can't control yourself. You know, you're not in control. When you sit in the chair, you're like, your body is, you're taken by something. And I said, oh, yeah. So you get more for your money. It's, you know, it's not intellectual. It's visceral. So, do I want to be part of any horror franchise? I want to be part of good writing. And people, so that's why people go to horror, and they like horror. I think, I mean, that's, unless somebody can tell me something else about it. Can you think of one that I should want to be part of? Because I want to know.
I didn't even know, like, maybe if you just like, well, you said Vince Gilligan, but even if it was Walking Dead, for example, or...
Walking Dead? I did see a couple of episodes. That's the zombie one. That was kind of cool. I stopped watching after about the third or fourth episode. I don't know. I was busy. I watch a lot of the New York Yankees, frankly. Anyway, it's interesting. Yeah, I want horror to be what it should, what it can be, you know, and what I think Saw helped move it to another level, and I hope it stays there. I haven't seen a lot of horror films since. Yes, sir.
Did you ever have the opportunity to sit with an audience and see them react to the ending of the first song?
Yeah, I did. In Agoura, California, I was in a theater one night with a beanie in the back row, and yeah, I did. And I was very pleased that, because when I read the script before I did it, before I met James, and I got there, that moment, I was like, fuck, I didn't expect that at all. And usually you do. Usually, I mean, I read a lot of scripts. Usually I know what's, or my mind would go to, or your mind will go to, oh, I bet it's that guy. Or this guy. I wasn't even thinking about that. I was, you know, I thought maybe it was the orderly, you know, but when I got to that, I was like, wow, if they shoot that right, nobody's going to expect it. And if they execute it properly, it's worth doing this film just for that moment. So people ask me all the time, why did you do Saw? And that's, that moment is pretty cool. It's a great moment, you know, like, it's lots of special moments. Like, see a film called Four Corners, John Turturro, you throw it? I was about to tell you the moment. I'm not going to do that. See the film, it's Four Corners with John Turturro. So maybe 20 years old, this film?
I'm just kind of curious about, with all of your success and the variety of work, has there been a part that you wanted that either you weren't able to accept or it was given to someone else that you were like, oh, I wish I had that?
No. No, I haven't felt that way. I have not yet done my best work. I haven't done it yet. So it's those parts that I'm looking for. You know, those opportunities. I've never felt that way in the past. I'm used to it. You know, being an actor is not an easy life. It's very, you don't, if you look for people's approval, you're doomed. I mean, and to some extent in life, it's like that, because you might be disappointed. So being an actor, you're constantly bombarded with, and often it's not about you. You know, they pick the fat guy with the beard, or the guy from the limp, you know, and you know, you go in and you go in again, and you know casting directors, and they know you, and you keep showing up. And if you believe, something will happen. Show up. If you don't show up, or you get out of the game, that's why those 53 jobs I was talking about, shit jobs are your best friends if you're on a mission. And they're hard to do. You feel like, fuck, I'm a failure. Look what I'm doing. But they're keeping you in the game. And if you can stay in the game, you have a chance of success. If you take that job as a tire salesman, you're out of the game. You know, I'm talking about, you know, a 9-to-5 job. You know, I used to work at night a lot so I could be available in the daytime to do those standing jobs and extra jobs. And, you know, keeps you in the game that you want to be in, it's your best friend and honorable, no matter how low it may be.
All right, everybody, put your hands together again for Jigsaw himself. Mr. Tobin.